SegaBits presents Sega Talk, a podcast talking all things
Sega!
With your hosts, George and Barry.
Look, it's a giant talking egg.
I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to the master here.
So what?
Hello and welcome to Sega Talk, episode number 64. I'm your host, George, and with me, like always, is the D to my E, Barry.
Hello, how are you? Thank you for watching.
I don't know why he's dressed like that. If you're watching this and not, just listening to this on audio or watching it on audio and thinking of what Barry looks like, he looks exactly what he sounds like.
I think if I zip this up to the top, I look like a European. Hello.
He's visiting Chicago with all the snow. Snowed in or yeah. Not snowed in yet?
No. I'm not snowed in. I was snowed in. I had to dig out the garage. It's insane here, which is perfect because we're playing a game that's very snowy.
Exactly.
I actually kind of feel like I'm living that game right now. I kind of just want to lay down and die in the snow. I'll be honest.
Like we announced, February is Kenji Eno month, and we talked about D last time. We kind of discussed some of his other games during that time. We kind of glazed over it. We talked about the packaging, which is something he was really known for. But today we're going to be talking about The Mighty Ducks 2, D2. No.
Yes.
No. It's a sequel.
Okay. An interview lined up and everything with the Emilio Estevez. So
he's on the podcast, right? We're going to be talking about D2.
I'll kick him off.
I wonder if there was any like confusion back then when kids were like, is this the D2 Mighty Ducks video game with a woman on?
They do put a hyphen. Did you notice that on the cover? It's not like straight D2. It's like D-2 or D.2.
So if we put this episode up, should we change the D to D-2?
I go based on the wikis, and the wikis just say straight up D2.
All right. I mean, maybe that would be up for argument with people watching this. You guys can tell us in the comments what you prefer. But I don't know. I don't really have a preference. To me, it's the same. When I was doing a lot of research on this game, the problem with it was every time I put D2, it always came out with Diablo 2 stuff, like the remaster of Diablo 2. I was just trying to see if there was any talk about remaking these games or like re-releasing them or remastering them. Not really. There's some fans that obviously want it and they're discussing that on forums, but nothing official or nothing licensed, nothing Sega related. Nobody's that I know of is approaching Sega trying to take these IPs off their hands because I'm assuming Sega owns some of it, right?
You know, it's hard to say. It runs on Sega hardware, obviously, but it's really hard to say who owns any of the warp materials now. I guess the best way you could look into it is that D re-release that was done on Steam, and maybe look at the credits there and see who the rights holder is. That's probably the best you could do, but I really can't say. Maybe a major corporation bought up the entire D, you know, like the Warp catalog.
It could have been
like the Prince of Saudi Arabia owns it or something.
Like always, these episodes are brought to you by you at home for supporting us on Patreon. This episode was actually Tyler's. He's been supporting us every month, and he has an episode every month. And he already told me what he wanted for next month. So, I mean, I might as well just say what he wants. I don't know what week it'll be, but Valkyria Chronicles is definitely going to have an episode next month. It's one of the earliest games that I covered as a Sega fan journalist. I don't know what you would call that. I'm putting quote marks. I don't
know.
Blogger, fan, fanatic, bothering Sega people, and please let me in. You want to read Tyler's memory before we get into our memories with D2?
Absolutely. So Tyler said, "It's quite the ride seeing Eno's craftsmanship and creativity grow with every title. He really put an emphasis on storytelling in his work, but I don't see today's crop of cinematic games growing from that. Instead, Eno's games weren't about making an interactive movie, but rather placing you in its world and experiencing everything it has to offer. Gameplay still remain the focus, and D2 succeeds at making you feel under attack and vulnerable. An excellent game that exemplified Eno throughout, a strange and beautiful work that will always be remembered." So thanks for watching, and No, we'll I made that joke last time too. These always seem like a summation. They're very good. Yeah. Now,
pretty much.
Now
right?
Let's hear our rambling memories. Yeah.
So, like we always start all these episodes. What's your memory with D2? Do you remember it when it was like being announced, hyped up, interviews, anything like that, or was it something that kind of went under your radar at the time?
As listeners and viewers may know, both you and I, we read official Dreamcast magazine as it came out. They did cover this game. So they did a pretty good job of like letting me understand exactly what it was all about. Still, I was confused. I was like, what? D2? Like, what a strange title. Oh, is it a sequel? Oh, it is. Where's the other D? Oh, it's on Saturn. Well, I don't own a Saturn. From what all accounts, I thought D2 was like a straight sequel and like these characters existed in a previous game. The storyline was continuing. And that actually was kind of a turnoff for the game. I mean, it's not like I refused to play it, but I was just kind of like, do I really want to go out and buy this game that's a sequel to a game that I've never played? Like, you got to remember like Shenmue 2, you know, like you're not going to play Shenmue 2 until you play Shenmue 1. And so I actually think it was kind of a mistake to title it D2 because it's so disconnected, both in terms of like era, console, everything. They're the only connection is that digital actress and a few other little things. But as you can see here, I did pick the game up years later. I bought it used for, I think, like $20. You know, like that's a good price. This is before the boom.
Yeah, the boom. Yeah, I was going to say, yeah. I was like, I'm pretty sure that sounds pretty cheap. I will say.
Yeah, I got it in Philly at the same place that I got a Sega Dreamcast like arcade stick for like $30. So.
And what was your overall impressions of the game? Because it's sort of trying to like mimic the survival horror kind of that was being pretty popular at the time. Like Illbleed, Blue Stinger, Code Veronica. How do you think these like compared and like what do you think about his take on the genre, I guess?
I was actually afraid to play this. Like I owned it, but I was afraid to really get into it because I had played some of Code Veronica and just found it a very difficult game for me. Just in terms of like the save system and how quickly I'd die. Same with Illbleed. Like Illbleed also feels like a very difficult game and kind of scary. Like Illbleed is like legit creepy. And so when I put this one on, I'm like, oh, this one's creepy too. And it's probably going to be hard. So I made a lot of judgments on this game based on my previous Dreamcast survival horror games. And having picked it up again, it's a lot easier than I remembered. I mean, it's not. I wouldn't say it is as easy as D, which I think is a pretty easy game. I wish I had had a better idea of what it was when it came out. You know,
I think overall the it was in Dreamcast magazines, but I felt like all they kind of did was discuss interviews with Kenji Eno, like he was like they were promoting him as a person, and I always felt like the game kind of took a back seat because we never really had a like I don't know like 8-page spread the way the Shenmue had about all the stuff it was doing new and how it was taking this genre to another level. This game might have not been like super technical, but graphically it did a lot of cool stuff I've never seen a lot of Dreamcast games do, except for maybe like House of the Dead 2, which is a rail shooter where like these creatures were like dropping, their eyes were falling out of their head. They look super disgusting. I don't think I've played a game like that since on the Dreamcast, only like maybe House of the Dead 2 with monsters that ugly. It has a very like The Thing feel to it, the movie, at least in the beginning of the game.
Absolutely.
Later on, it kind of gets a little bonkers. And I think people back then even complained about it being a little mundane with the gameplay being repetitive. I would agree that the third-person gameplay wasn't all fleshed out. You could tell this is the first time ever doing this. And it's pretty, like, how do you say, small? I don't know. It's just kind of, like, gets a little boring sometimes, but it's also their longest game, 9 hours, I would say, 8 hours. I'm just guesstimating.
Absolutely.
I really like a lot of the way that they directed it. I like some of the models, the monsters, and I really, really like the music. It has its moments where it's really, really, really good, and then sometimes when it's a little generic, but it's up to people to judge that. We'll talk about the music later, but that's just my thoughts while we start the game. Mm. Let's talk about where we left off, right? Last time, Barry gave us a good look at the early career of Kenji Eno. So I think it's important that we talk about him after the success of D. Like Barry said on the podcast, D was a massive success for the studio, selling over 1 million units. This even after Sony tried to sabotage it by only shipping a low amount of units, I think most developers would probably have chased the success of D and like right away just made D2. Like, okay. But he didn't, even though he did bring back Laura. Warp made a tiny game right after this called Short Warp, which we talked about in the other one, which had like pervy mini games. It had 10,000 units. And they were all signed by Kenji Eno himself. I just can't even imagine. Like, you sell a million units of D, and then you're like signing 10,000 units of these mini game for the 3DO.
Absolutely. I want to see if you can find that. That sounds awesome.
To have his signature and having, because it's like he touched each one of these games. They gave it the love and intention. Oh, yeah. So I mean, that means a lot. That's how much he loves his fans. Kenji Eno would evolve Laura with the 1996 game Enemy Zero, which honestly deserves its own episode because it does some really unique aspects to the game. The dog's going crazy. And actually has a lot of talent attached to it. I don't know if you actually looked into Enemy Zero and the people that worked on the game, but it's been known for its minimalistic music from English composer. What's his name? He did the music score for Gattaca. I don't know if I put his name here. Oh, Michael Newman? I don't
know. Oh, okay. Yeah.
He did Gattaca, and he did a bunch of other movies. He's really popular in, like, orchestra scene. So now I lost my place. But that game definitely deserves its own episode. Have you played Enemy Zero?
I own it. It's the Japanese version, though, so I have not really dived into it. I'd have to use a walkthrough or something like that. I will say, just to bring it up, I did find Short Warp. There's two copies for sale on eBay. One's 50, one's 80. I don't see any sign of him actually signing it, but maybe, I do see a card that's
maybe
numbered.
Maybe he didn't sign it.
It's hand numbered, though.
It's hand numbered. There you go. Maybe he did hand number, not signed. So yeah, but one gameplay aspect of Enemy Zero that Kenji Eno took to heart was it revolving around the game using sound. In that game, enemies are invincible, so you have to use your sound to figure them out. This led Kenji Eno to designing 1997 Sega Saturn and later Dreamcast game. Real sound, Kaze no Regret, or as it means, Wind of Regret. Inji Eno would he made the game because he got several fan letters from blind fans saying that they really appreciated the way he I'm assuming Enemy Zero at the time, and then it made him come up with the idea for Real Sound, which is the first game as it was marketed back then with no graphics. While today game companies are working and talking about making games easier for disabled people, like Microsoft has a controller they built from the ground up for people that have, like, they can't use their hands correctly, so they could, it makes it easier for them to play games. What are your thoughts about him doing this in the mid 90s and trying to design games around disabilities?
I mean, I think it's very admirable. I think it's very cool. It's just a shame that, like, this is the one game. Like, not, I haven't played it. I don't know how good it is, but that must kind of stink to be like, hey, are there any games for the blind? And being told, there's one. I hope you like it, you know? Can you imagine that? Like, having one video game that is really catering to you out of the entire, really, history of video games?
That must be rough. I think there's, like, little things that Japanese developers could do better to make their games easier for disabled people, like people that are impaired visually. Like, I don't know if you've seen this video. There's a blind player that played Street Fighter 5, And they talked about how he would put his headphones on and he could tell what side of the screen he was on or where the person was at by the sounds and how close the sounds were to his. So there's some sound design in some games that do work, but obviously they're not catered from the ground up. It just happens that they learned about, you know, sight of sound, I guess. It's just sound design that happened to work for them, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm, but yeah, absolutely. I have to agree. I think he was ahead of the curve here. And I was actually laughing when I was doing research on this because they were talking about how this is one of the most popular games for Japanese blind players to play. And I'm like, there's not that many games for them to play. So
right.
It's yeah. Like a game from like 1997. That's not good. What do you think about... Oh, sorry. I haven't even gotten into the freaking spoilers. We're going to be talking about spoilers for this game. I'll have a... screen that says spoilers if you're gonna play real sound. I don't think anybody will be playing real sound here, right?
You know who has... I was just gonna interrupt you real quick. You know who does have games for the blind is the Amazon Alexa. They have interactive games that are like choose your own adventure, but you have to like keep mental notes on things. There's man, what's that John Krasinski drama? Tom Clancy. Anyway, yeah, so that does exist. There's a Scooby-Doo one also. So
there's visual novels in Japan, but I wonder how playable they are without the visual part, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Anyway, so, sorry, I was just thinking.
It's all right. I was going to say, Eno is the guy that pushed Sega to make real sound, seeing that he basically burned bridges with Sony to support Sega and publish a million-plus seller on the Sega Saturn. Sega got exclusive rights for real sound. That was their exclusive. That was their little agreement. As part of the deal, Sega donated 1,000 Sega Saturns to the hospital for the blind in Tokyo. He donated 1,000 units of his game out of his pocket. Since we'll never have an episode of Win or Regret, because, I mean, let's be honest, nobody played that game, in America at least, and most likely won't get localized in English, thus making it unplayable for us non-Japanese speakers, let's talk about the story, which revolves around the idea of fear and love, and was written by Takamatsu Ogawa, who I was looking up. They said he wrote Enemy Zero in some Wikipedia entries, but I looked into the credits and actually he was a sound designer for Enemy Zero. So it's like, and it's also, there might be another person with the same name as him, but there's a person with the same name as him that is credited for doing sound design work on Final Fantasy VII, Metal Gear Solid 2, Metal Gear Solid 3, and Folklore for Sony. But they might have the same names because when I look him up, if he's credited for D... and Warp Games, he's not credited for the Square Enix games or Metal Gear Solid games. So it might be one of those, like, they have the same name, right?
I mean, this happened with the Tails voice actor, remember that?
Yeah. And the Wikipedia entries for Warp staff, it's lacking. I'll say that. After researching a lot and trying to track some of these people down, what they're doing and stuff for the future, later in the episode, it was kind of a pain in the ass, so... the game's story revolves around two young lovers. I've heard two things, elementary school and middle school, so and high school, so I don't know. Mitsu Sakura and Hiroshi Nonotti, who fall in love in school and plan to secretly run away together, meeting under a clock tower. Mitsu never showed up, and shortly she is transferred to a new school. The game continues to follow Hiroshi in college and Mitsu as she's trying to basically get a job. All of a sudden, there's mysterious disappearances in the subway system. The game then puts you in the perspective of these characters, but then changes the story to a kind of like a narrator role where he's watching all the characters. Eno planned on Real Sound being a trilogy. The game was supposed to lead to more games. The disappearances in the subway actually ties into the premise of the beginning of the game about the love. I don't know if it does. We'll talk about the spoilers in a little bit, but I don't know if it does. The sequel to this game, which we will talk about a little bit later, was meant to be a horror title. Since the way the game works, it's a visual novel minus the visual part. And randomly, a user will hear a chim in the game, like a little bell. and that's when you're supposed to pick what part, where the story goes, and you get to pick the outcome of your story. It has three endings, but so far, does real sound sound like something you'd like to experience in English, or does this deserve a second look by publishers?
I would love to see fans do a remake of this. I mean, you really would just need to replace the audio files on disc. We've seen that with Shenmue. They did a re-release. It was the American version of Shenmue with the Japanese voices. So I could totally see... The only thing is you probably have to keep the time the same, you know what I mean? Like for each track.
Yes.
Which shouldn't be a huge problem. We see that all the time with dubbing, you know, you just probably have to talk a little faster or something like that. The story itself kind of sounds like a Studio Ghibli movie. Like if you've ever seen the ones that are more grounded, it's always about like people being friends and moving away. And then there's like a weird little like... a supernatural bit, like I'm trying to think, like The Cat Returns, I think it was something like that, you know. So I'd love to try it. I really hope some fans eventually make an English language version. That would be awesome, or at least subtitle a playthrough, you know.
There's a lot of new Dreamcast games and like Sega Saturn games are getting translated by fans. There's this Russian guy that's been doing a bunch of Dreamcast games, and I mean, if he's listening to this, hey, dude, Barry will do the voice for one of the female, and I'll do the male. Well, I actually
love you
think,
so much.
Yeah. I think they might both be female in this thing, but I'm not 100% sure because and also it's ambiguous sex
that was
later.
Creepy.
Yeah, so
the on Conan when he goes ooh and she goes I don't like when you do that. What this?
let's get into spoilers in the game.
Let's spoil this game.
You thought it was going to be weird. You thought the story was weird or the concept of the game was weird. It gets even weirder. In a section of the game, we actually get images. Even if real sound is advertised as a no graphics type game, there's actually pictures and it's actually related to the story. But it seems to be low-resolution background photos of random places in Japan, including women smiling at the camera, homeless people, etc. As the game gets further into the story, the pictures become more intimate, showing off a small private apartment, views of the balcony. The photos get more Christian as it depicts Japanese valley girls wearing crucifixes. A part of the narrative is comparing Mitsu and Hiroshi's love to Adam and Eve. Slowly, these features go from random everyday apartments walking around to slowly going into the sewer. The way that the game has branching paths is that you get to explore different parts of the sewer if you have different answers. It's kind of weird. So it'd be like you'd be somebody that's visually impaired and you'll be picking answers and there'll be pictures on the screen and you're in a sewer and you can't see, but like there's pictures, but you visually can see as the player, but there's visuals going on, like you're going into danger, but you can't see it. You know what I mean? So some of the endings seem like a dead end. Like the standard obvious path, which is the guy said, it's kind of like when you play a game and they want you to answer this way. He did it that way first. He says that the sewer starts. You go into the sewer that leads you to a dead cat where you take a picture of it, and it says "congratulations" in really tacky word art. If you take the Maverick path, which is the Alpha Chad path, the one they don't want you to take, the game tries to avoid. You will get a different set of photos when you reach the sewer section. Going further down in a different path, the last photo shows a ceiling of a sewer and in a canal. With a flash of the photo of a graffiti on the ceiling with a pair of eyes and hands, like with the eyes in his hands. If the last two paths were good and evil in terms of dialogue trees, the last and third ending would be the neutral path. This time, again, we have the photographer taking photographs going into the sewer. Only this time he exits, climbing up the ladder leading to the surface world. As the light shines into the camera, the person turns the camera and takes a photo of themselves looking into the lens. The image is blurred and pixelated, hard to tell if it's even a woman or man. The person seems to be in a populated urban center where they exit. The image sits and the screen gets to the same tacky congratulations word art. But this time it shows a cutesy pink and white pointing to the person saying, "This is Mitsu." And a second seconds later, the white giant kanji says, "Mitsu is dead." So now that we talked about the spoilers on the game, and we'll be moving on directly to D2 after the spoilers seem to have taken I guess it's a photograph of a serial killer. I don't know. Is part of the narrative yet it's so okay. So what do you think about the idea that this game is sold for the blind, yet there's pictures and ideas behind it where it tells a narrative through the pictures in a way?
Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, I had thought at first it was just to make the game accessible for people who could see and they wanted to look at something.
And that's the problem. But the person that put the spoilers didn't talk about what they were talking about, what the sound on the screen was. He fixated on the photos, you know?
Right. I mean, maybe they do describe it in the audio. I would have to imagine. I can't imagine like playing a trick on the player and being like, "Oh, you can't see this, but something real creepy is happening." Unless the thought is that if you have someone who can see, they like bring it up with the person and then they have a conversation, you know, and it's like trying to, I don't know.
I do like the idea of like, it's kind of like a VR, you know. He would have made some really sick VR games if he was still around. Like the idea when you play a VR game where people that are watching you play on the screen, they know something's happening, but you can't see it on the VR. So people getting tensed up around you would be like, "Okay, don't do that." And you're like, "Why not? I mean, yeah, look at this." You don't know what's going on. That makes it a spectator game, kind of, you know, a little cool. I thought that aspect of it was cool, but the whole like, if you need the pictures, I can't play it, I can't tell you, kind of ruins the experience for for somebody that can't see. So what do you think about the ending? What does it have to do with fear and love, which is supposed to be two of the ideas behind the story?
I mean, I guess it's about loss. It seems to be death.
The only thing I thought about maybe was that Mitsu died in the future, and maybe this guy's like regretting that they didn't run away together, and now he saw that she's one of the missing people in the subway, and he's kind of having this basically regret, where it's this weird story being told in this like fever dream.
Oh yeah, that could be it.
Because she didn't show up to their little runaway together, and all of a sudden she starts she's the dead person in the end of the story. So
that's not creepy at all.
That's not creepy at all. So let me mention some of the cool aspects of this game. It was actually, they had a one playthrough thing aired at on Tokyo FM in 1997. Wish I was in Japan. Mm-hmm. Listen to that. That would have been interesting. Like stated before, Eno planned the series to be a trilogy with a sequel called Real Sound Kiri no Left of Organ. That's what I read when I did the translation. This one was supposed to be marketed as a horror game, even though the actual we actually had an advertisement for it.
Was a commercial.
Oh, and a commercial. Okay, I didn't know that, but I do know that there's an ad.
Kenji's in it.
Two page spread, and it never happened, which is weird, right? Like it got more promo than D2. It almost felt like.
Wow.
He says it never came out because of compression issues, which I think it was something that he really struggled with his games a lot, because like they're like 1,000 discs usually.
Yeah.
Some of the aspects of this game actually made it into D2, I'm assuming when you go blind or deaf, which is part of the gameplay in the game. And the last one was supposed to be called Real Sound Spy Lunch. Lunch like eating lunch. And it was supposed to be a comedy title, which, come on, is weird, right?
Yeah, that's really weird.
Lastly, the soundtrack was done by Keiichi Suzuki, who did the RPG series music for Mother, aka Earthbound games for Nintendo. And like every single Japanese composer actually contributed music for Super Smash Bros. Brawl. Anything you want to say about Real Sound before we leave to D2?
Just that it's underrated, but I don't blame it for being underrated because it's very inaccessible for you know, us non-Japanese speakers. But, you know, if you're listening, if you are a audio engineer or you have an interest in, you know, Dreamcast development, I don't know, try to assemble a team, make real sound English happen. I'd like that. Just for me.
Just for us, because we want to play. We want to know what's up with the story. We want to know what it says, you know? I think experiencing it is totally different than just talking about what somebody else
Absolutely.
Especially when it comes to these games. But anyway.
Playthroughs are not a alternative to playing a game.
Warp's first title came out in 1994. They would add one title, at least one title, sometimes two, a year until 1997's A Real Sound. Like we know, he was supposed to be doing more Real Sound games. It didn't happen. This would mean that the studio wouldn't have released the game in 1998, but that changed in 1998-9 when Warped re-released Real Sound on the Dreamcast and then began promoting D2. But how long was Kenji Eno working on D2 behind the scenes? According to the official Dreamcast magazine interview with him, he started two years before it came out. Some people were saying even longer because I think there's like interviews about him talking about this game like right after D. So, and then it was we'll talk about it. But yeah, before it was released in December 23rd, 1999. The early version of D2 was actually not a Dreamcast exclusive, but meant to be on both the Dreamcast and the Panasonic M2, a console that never came out. So before we get into the interview, have you ever heard, or back in the day when we were growing up and we were all into games, and did you remember the Panasonic M2 being a thing?
No, and I mean, I like Panasonic as a brand. I never thought of them as making a console. It seems like it's more in line with like the 3DO or even the Philips CDI, where it's like a manufacturer of, I don't know, like televisions and things, making a console, which is not a problem, but it's just, it's interesting. I would have loved to try it. I like Panasonic.
Have you seen any of the games that like are based off of M2 hardware? Like they kind of look like Nintendo 64 games.
Interesting.
It's not terrible graphics, but I think if you go on the Panasonic website, if you go all the way down on games, there's a list of a few games that released. We'll be looking at D2 in a little bit, some of the M2 version of the game, because they actually released it. But first, I actually never heard of it growing up either, so I'm with you on that one. This is what Kenji Eno had to say in the interview. We've been working on this for about 2 years. D2 for M2 and D2 for Dreamcast are totally different. The initial stage of Dreamcast development, since we aimed to release simultaneously on the Dreamcast launch, which didn't happen, it was the same as the M2 version, but I just changed my mind to a different game. I have changed the setting and the game contents too. Also, the final version of D2 is different from what we first had planned. I am very glad he's very glad with the Dreamcast's capabilities. D2 turned out to be like this. So he changed the game. Let me see if I put it here. Okay. Reading the actual plot of the old D2 would confirm this, as the early version of the game, Laura is pregnant and is riding in a plane to Romania when the plane is struck by a supernatural force, resulting in the plane crashing and her unborn child being taken by the devil to a medieval Transylvania castle. To medieval Transylvania, the time period, to be given to a widowed duke who sold her soul for a son. The game actually revolves around Laura's son entering adulthood and trying to escape a large castle as he fights the devil to save his father. Confusing, yes, but some of the themes here really do go back to the first D, including the settings of the castle. While the D series is known for full motion cutscenes, the prototype had the story told in real-time graphics, so no cutscenes. Did you know about the penis? Oh, yeah, we already said that. What are your thoughts about the game actually being about Laura's son? Do you think that would have been more interesting, and it kind of seems like it would have tied more into the idea of like your daughter or your offspring, like D.
Yeah, no, I like this actually. It seems much more like something fitting of the D2 title. I mean, you've got everything there that really sets up the gameplay that you did in the original D, except this time you're the son. It could easily be a follow-up, even if they say, oh, it's a different main character named Laura who looks the same. You know, like, because if I remember correctly, she survives if you get the good ending. So, yeah, that's interesting. And I remember, too, when we did our last episode, I talked about how he was inspired by these point-and-click games that were inside castles and in, like, spooky settings. So it really seems like he kept trying to work on this format. So it's interesting that he shifted away from kind of the same setting and the same sort of ideas.
I was going to say, we're going to look at a clip. I don't know if you see it on the notes. I just added it under the question.
Yeah, I see that.
This is the... Okay, so last... No, 2 years ago in 2019, somebody got a Panasonic M2 prototype... I mean, dev kit. And inside was an actual working version of D2. The old one.
Oh, wow.
And this is like 10 minutes of footage. I'm just going to... You can click around on your side. I'll click around over here where people are looking at it. As you could tell, it was totally different. It has like... actual combat with a sword they show a little bit of. It's very... He said it was 50% done before they finished... Before he canceled it. So it kind of... obviously not playable. Not super playable, but playable enough that there's like an actual like skeleton around it, you know? Like he could have used this on Dreamcast and just updated a lot of it.
Yeah.
Later on, it shows you outside the castle. So instead of... So a lot of the gameplay of like running around outside, like in the snow... was actually in this game or this prototype, and it was like just their version, and it shows some effects they were doing on the M2. But yeah, there's not that much in here, but it's interesting that they were working on it. It kind of looks like a Sega Saturn game, doesn't it?
Reminds me of the Shenmue prototypes on Saturn,
right? And this was supposed to be teased for Saturn too, but he never officially announced it. He just teased it. Like, oh, it's going to happen on Saturn, maybe, one day. But yeah, what do you think about this? And what do you think about Eno, like, being a year and a half into development and being like, scrap it. We're going to be snow now and a totally new engine on the Dreamcast. How would that make you feel as an artist, like, throwing away all that work?
I mean, I've done it before as an artist. I can definitely understand, you know, how annoying it must be, but also how probably refreshing it is to move on to hardware that probably has far fewer limitations. I mean, same could be said about Yu Suzuki with Shenmue. He did so much work, even to the point of, like, developing things from Shenmue 2 and Shenmue 3 on the Saturn and scrapping it all. Even Sonic, I think they did some Sonic Adventure, like early prototypes on the Saturn. So it seems like it was really, just because the Saturn had such a short lifespan that it wasn't just D2 that was going through this.
So we cannot talk about, D2 without talking about Kenji Eno and his like... The way he promotes games is something else. So actually, when he was teasing the game all the way back in Tokyo Game Show 97, before the game was officially showing off, typical Eno fashion, he basically put up a booth, but instead of it showing off D2, he said it was celebrating cherry blossom season that was happening in Japan. He did this, so the event's 3 days. He did it for the first 2 days. Then on the last day, he finally showed off the D2 demo. To anyone that stuck around, I guess, for 2 days, right? Was like checking up on him, like, did he release it today or is he... So what do you think about him doing this, like, basically making people wait, wasting 2 days of foot traffic and, I guess, reviewers and critics and fans to do it whenever he wants, just because why not? It's funny, that's why.
I mean, I have to wonder, was maybe the public day on the last day?
I don't know. But it was so long ago, knowing that back then it was probably just press, you know? Like, I remember, like, when did E3 actually open up to the public? But then again, I know some people that said they went to the Dreamcast E3, and I'm like, why did they let you? You're not a journalist, dude.
Right, yeah. Their daddy knew someone.
Of course. I wish my dad knew people. So the next part is something I don't like to do, because this story is so complex and there's so weird things where, like, characters pop in and then they leave, and then you're like, what was that character doing here? All right. So anyway, if I get anything wrong and you want to correct me, this game is like a fever dream sometimes. So
it is.
Just like the original version of the game, our protagonist, Laura Parton? Is that how you say her name?
Parton. Like Parton? Dolly Parton.
Ooh, so she's related, you think?
Isn't
an airplane taking a trip to Canada instead of Transylvania? When suddenly the plane is attacked by cultist terrorists taking over the plane, an onboard FBI agent named David tries to fight the terrorists, but the plane comes crashing down when a freaking meteor strikes and hits the plane, striking it down to the Canadian wilderness.
Of course.
We know, Laura is a digital actress used by Warped, and Kenji Eno starred in all the games, Enemy Zero, D, and this one. After a plane going to Canada is taken over by... Okay, I don't know why I wrote this again. I think I was trying to... Okay. She is saved. She wakes up after nightmares with this character called Kimberly Fox, who was actually in Enemy Zero. Again, another actress, which I thought was interesting, though, because I don't know. I think it's interesting because I don't think Japan had a pretty good depiction of women, especially people of color. Like, anything they didn't understand in Japan, it was really bad. I feel like Eno kind of understood women and the minorities a little more. I mean, she's a poet. She didn't have
people
a huge
of color.
Thing.
Yeah, people of color in Japanese games are almost always a big, burly black guy.
Pretty much,
almost
always. So I'm surprised Kimberly is not a burly black guy. So that's what I'm trying to tell you.
Maybe.
Kimberly,
hey, Laura.
Kimberly explains she found Laura 2 days ago. But the plane crashed 10 days ago. She found her 2 days ago. So there's 8 days that she didn't know what she was doing. She has amnesia. She doesn't know what happened. And then at this moment, they're stopped by another survivor, one of the cultists who turns into a plant-like monster. Next, Laura and Kimberly meet Peter Parker, a CTI researcher, and another crash survival who kills off the monster. Since Kimberly doesn't trust him, he leaves. The game has Laura try to survive in the wilderness and find a way of contacting the outside world while seeking survivors, all while finding more strange and hideous creatures that lurk in the mountains. During the game, Laura is pushed deeper into the mining facility in order to rescue a girl named Janie. Janie? Is that what her name is? Who is a
Janie?
Little girl that Kimberly says went missing, but she found her with Laura when she was in the plane site. I don't know how that works. How can a little girl run away in the winter, you know? It's like...
Right.
Come on. Anyway, what is your opinion of D2 expanding and having more characters? The game actually has way more cutscenes, and it was actually kind of panned for critics for having too many cutscenes. What are your opinion on the cutscenes now and then, or all this stuff?
Okay, like when we discussed D, I don't know if it was a complaint of mine, but I did wish that there were more characters just for her to work off of, have conversations with.
Definitely,
I mean,
has
when
more
it's just
than the
her,
first one.
Right? Yeah, when it's just her and her dad, like, it just seemed so small. So it's nice that they opened it up. I like that they were bringing in characters from Enemy Zero. As far as more cutscenes, like, you have to remember this was a time when, you know, there was just so much more that you could do in video games. And so I think a lot of developers and artists who felt like they were kind of, their hands were kind of tied with previous games, especially in the, like, Genesis era, they finally could tell stories. They could have cutscenes. I mean, I guess a lot of people give grief to Metal Gear Solid for basically being movies with, like, little gameplay sections. But No, I don't have a major problem with the cutscenes. I mean, sure, the voice acting's not amazing. Then again, people will, you know, claim up and down that Shenmue is the best Dreamcast game ever, and yet the voice acting is atrocious, you know? So,
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I would say it has its problems. I think all Dreamcast games that were trying to be cinematic sometimes didn't go all the way because there wasn't a precedent. I mean, or a precedent. Like, Metal Gear Solid was, like, just came out. Some of these guys were literally working when the first Metal Gear Solid came out. And, like, there's not that many games that use full motion cutscenes back then. So when I see something like Sonic, where I'm like, okay, Sonic Team could have definitely used some work here on the capturing of the mouth. It makes sense, though, because, right. like, especially this one where it was done in Japanese and it was a low-budget game and then they had to dub it. I will say that... I didn't put in the notes, but the American version also is censored. I read somewhere from Save America back then that it's like 60 seconds they took out, but the other people online are saying it's way more than that. This is Sega of America from 1990, so I mean, like, they could have lied to us, right? Or 2000s. So
right.
One of them is a technical scene where it doesn't show penetration. I guess in the Japanese one's a little longer, shows a little more. So I guess if you're going to play the game, maybe Japanese if you want to see the tentacle porn. But we're going to be talking about spoilers in this section for D2. So if you want to experience D2, you should probably skip this part all the way till... Well, I have an image on the video, so you'll kind of see when it's over. So
I had the lizard last time. Remember that?
Yeah, I just put an image on here that says spoilers. So the lizard's up. The further D2 goes, the further we get into more occult mysticism and doomsday talk, as we find out that the main antagonist wants to bring back the shadow to create a perfect society in his image. The game talks about genetic engineering and clones. That should be my username online, generic engineering.
I like that.
Which gets even more crazier as the game continues. It seems these mutated plants monsters came from them trying to clone a woolly mammoth. At the time, finding something else, Laura is a combination of a monster and human DNA, making her a messiah-like figure that needs to merge with darkness to save the world from Armageddon. Simple and dimple. But the game ends with a 15-minute cinematic cutscene where Laura travels back to 1999. Was it 99? Yeah, before the New Year's, right? And ensures that the universe stays at the right path. Here she meets her eternal protector, David, and she succeeds. We see all the good she has done from the starts of dinosaurs to cavemen. Then it starts getting a little grimmer with World War II, moon landing, the destruction of the Berlin Wall, ending with even worse epidemics like starving children. Showing that maybe Laura can't change the world and humanity is both beautiful and disgusting. I don't know.
Wow.
But the game ends with some stats. They're not all the stats here, but I did a nice little game for us where we're going to play a game show. Basically, I'm going to read the... So basically, in the end of the game, there's a bunch of stats about the world, like how many people go hungry, how much climate change is affecting us. And everything is from 1998 when the game was coming out. So I'm going to do an update to 2020 and see if any of these problems have been solved in the last whatever years we've been alive. I'm trying to do the latest. Sometimes it's 2019, sometimes it's 2020 or, you know, whatever. So the first one, world population growth in 1998, about 78 million. How many do you think grew, let's see, in 2020? Like, just the year.
What's the population now?
Growth. I mean, like, they said in 1998, it grew 78 million. Do you think it's in 2020, population grew up or down? Just in the year 2020. Up. You're right. 81 million per year. The next one. Number of people infected with HIV virus worldwide. 1980 was about 100,000. In 1998, it was about 33 million. What about now?
I'm going to say it went down, but not by much.
Close. In 2019, it was about 38 million, so it went up slightly still.
But you'd have to think in 2020, it's going to go down.
Maybe, yeah.
Because people weren't around each other.
Yeah. I'm hoping so. the next one is AIDS-related deaths worldwide in 1998, about 2.5 million, up or down?
Up.
2019, about 690,000, so less than a million. So, yeah, definitely way down.
Oh, okay.
Number of starving people worldwide in 1998 was about 83 million. 830 million.
Up.
2019 was about 690 million, so it's down.
Oh.
And the population grew, so, I mean, you know, take that into account.
That's something.
Number of illiterate people worldwide in 1998, about 1 billion. Do you think we have more illiterates or less?
Less.
773 million, so yeah, less illiterate people, but less people using
the
brain.
I think the internet was a reason.
I think so too, you know, people reading Facebook, they have to learn, you know, for the maymays.
You gotta read reading memes. Yeah.
Number of children worldwide who died from malnutrition and related diseases in 1998. About 19,000 children died every day. Do you think
this
more
is the grimmest game show I've ever been on?
Thank you. It's a D2 game show. It makes sense. So 19,000 up or down?
Up.
24,700 people in 2019. Mm-hmm. So definitely not good. But then again, like we said, population's also gotten up. So maybe if we do the mathemication, still not good because I feel like we're getting fatter. I mean, as we go along, it's almost no excuse to not feed these children the bare basics.
We have to give people money.
Average life expectancy, 1900s, about 35 years. 1997, about 67 years. Up or down?
Up.
Yep, 2019 was about 78.8 years. Ooh. So, yeah, we're going to be living.
How long are we going to live?
Dude, I'm hoping for like 100, 102. No. Well, whenever the Dreamcast 2
George.
Comes out.
Yeah, that's right.
Rainforest destruction from 1980 to 1995 was about 772,204 square miles. How much do you think that went up or down? I think I did one where it was like 15 years or something. So up or
I
down?
I think it went down.
You're right. From 2000 to 2018, there was only 198,077 square miles of rainforest.
That's because that movie Ferngully came out. Remember that?
Well, I thought it was because D2 said this and everyone was like, oh, we need to calm the hell down. Kenji Eno's going to make another game and call us out.
Yeah.
Percentage of plant species on the verge of extinction in 1997 was about 14%. Up or down?
I'm going to say up.
Yeah, it's about 40% in 2020.
Yeah, it's
so that's
not
huge.
Good.
Total number of species to go extinct annually in 1998 is about 1,000. What about now?
Up.
You're right. In 2019, it was estimated from 10,000 almost all the way to 100,000 species might go extinct. And
I got a good book about extinct animals too. You should check this out. It's good.
Ooh, are those dinosaurs? Never heard of
them. It's from the guy who wrote Hitchhiker's Guide. It's a travel log. He went and looked for animals on the verge of extinction, and he writes about it. It's pretty good.
So now that we're done here, what do you make? Let me put the spoiler image back up. What do you make of the? Well, okay. What do you make of the ending? How did Eno go from a horror game that felt like John Carpenter's The Thing to showing the negative effects of scientists' experiments to basically going full woke at the end of the game? What do you think his message was with this game at the end?
You know, it's hard to say. With D, it really just felt like twist, you know, like an M. Night Shyamalan twist, but it made sense. You're like, oh, wow, D, okay. In this one, though, you know, there is no real D2. they don't tell you what D means, really. Maybe demon? I don't know. The whole thing, though, with Shadow and DNA and all that, like, it sounds like Sonic Adventure 2, I'll be honest. Because Shadow was a genetic experiment to create the ultimate life form, and didn't they use, like, alien DNA, it turned out? Like, just crazy stuff like that. As far as Laura being, like, a messiah and all that, it kind of reminds me of that movie, The Devil's Advocate. Remember that? with oh, man, who's in that? Keanu Reeves and Pacino, I think Pacino or something. But yeah, so it's just, it kind of seems like of the time there was a lot of like doom and destruction sort of stories being told in 1999 because a lot of people were legitimately scared of what the new millennium would bring. And you know, now looking back, it's kind of funny because it seems like all the things that they feared came 20 years later. You know, like if you were to tell these people, hey, it's not going to be the year 2000, it's going to be added 20, it's going to be 2020, you know. Also with these statistics, I think it's Eno's way of bringing the real world into the game. I know a lot of people don't like when that happens. But honestly, like, not every game needs to be escapism. Not every game needs to be just, like, a fun, quirky little thing. And, you know, it's interesting. I don't have the Japanese version of the game, but when you look at the American version, it's very Americanized. Like, it's just, like, a terrifying adventure, you know, features over 30 gruesome monsters. Like, I feel like these are not things that Eno would relatively care about. Like, I feel, if anything, like, he would be putting statistics on the inside of the box or have like a postcard to send your grandma or something, like just weird stuff like that. But yeah, this true, one, I open it up true. And I just feel like I'm looking at Shenmue, you know, like character pretty faces, much. You know, and I kind of regret that they kind of stripped the game of his personality and these sorts of things. Like this is the guy who would give you seed packets and condoms for free with games, so I guess this was his freebie, was just like a bunch of downer statistics about dead children and AIDS.
I did think about it a lot, and I'm thinking, I don't know, the conclusion I came with, you could tell me if I'm looking into it harder than anybody else, but like, so this idea that Laura, like this idea of these scientists and religious cultists, it's kind of like the bridging of like how in the 21st century or going into the 21st century, we had these like huge religious people going, this, the doomsday, blah, blah, blah. And scientists saying doomsday because of all these ideas, but none of them doing anything about it. Like instead of the scientists actually fixing the world, he's trying to like clone woolly mammoths. It's like, bro, we got all these problems in the world. And your focus is cloning woolly mammoths and causing destruction and furthering damage. And then these religious people want to, like, make the world what they want it to be, even though the world's already crap. So you're not really working with what you got. You just living in a fantasy of a different world. But, yeah. I think that's his little, like, him trying to talk shit about science and religion. That's kind of what it felt like to me. And it's like, look at all these problems you guys have. What are you guys cloning animals for? I mean, what do we need animals
for? Right, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe pretentious, maybe a little bit, but that's how artists are, right?
Absolutely.
I think one of my favorite aspects of D2 was the gameplay. While it wasn't perfect, I think it was wrapped everything Warp did with their previous experimental games and sort of perfected it into something really interesting. While D and Enemy Zero played mostly in first person, in FMV style looking games, D2 on the other hand was fully 3D, taking full advantage of the Dreamcast's hardware. There is even moments where the game looks even better than Capcom's Code Veronica, if not at least rival it. That's my opinion here. But the game also draws back ideas that they used in previous games. For example, going into buildings or fighting would trigger a first person view mode. that it's a throwback to the original. The fighting, like mentioned, is like a light gun game type of shooting where you can't move and you shoot the enemies on screen. And then you like get rewards and power chips, I think that's what it was. Kenji Eno would also play with the idea of taking away the player's hearing and sight, something that he obviously did in Real Sound and in Enemy Zero. In an interview with the game, Eno talked about his thoughts on Shenmue, where he said it felt like a game he would try to make. And D2 really convinced me that, of course, that he probably would make a game like Shenmue. Like, sometimes when you're walking and opening the door, it takes so long. I'm like, bro, you Suzuki come in here and make this for you, or what? Do you just copy and paste it? Like, what's this?
Right, right, where he's just like...
Yeah, like, that's the no modern... It takes a special type of person that wants to see that attention to detail to put that in.
Right, you know? Exactly.
There are also a few aspects of the game that I felt... that I thought were kind of modern, that surprisingly modern. Like, for example, the hunting aspects for food, the ability to, for Laura to use her camera just to take photographs, nothing else, just to enjoy the scenery. And you can save them on your VMU for later viewing and sharing. I don't know if you noticed this, but photo modes are actually something that has been added to a lot of new games lately. Like, mostly Nintendo games and Sony titles all have like these like really in-depth photo modes. I guess people are really into sharing photos now with the social media. So imagine this game. What are your thoughts on about the gameplay of D2? Is there any aspects of the game that you dislike that didn't work? And anything that if they ever made a sequel, you would like to see like further refined?
I think what I like about the gameplay is it's very varied. Playing it actually kind of reminded me of course, Shenmue, but also Headhunter. Just in that, like, you jump on a motorcycle in Headhunter, and in this you jump on a snowmobile. And that's not something I would see in games that much back then. The fact that you typically were just a character who walked around. If you did get into something, it was usually like a stationary gun or something like that. I remember it kind of really became exciting with Halo, with the Warthogs. So it was just kind of fun to see these like full roaming adventure games just like give you new modes of transportation. I think my complaint would be though that there are like a lot of areas that just feel like corridors. You're just kind of walking up a hill and then you hit the side of a mountain and you know, nothing really interesting. I also think the light gun game idea is fun. It kind of reminds me of man, what's that game for the Sega CD? Snatcher, you know, where it's like, it's an adventure game, and then all of a sudden it's like, do light gun stuff. And it's fun, because I actually really appreciate when games throw in like a retro sort of gameplay style to act as a stand-in for combat. I guess maybe a modern one would kind of be Yakuza Like a Dragon, you know, where instead of being a fighting game, it just throws classic RPG elements at you, which I think is kind of fun. So yeah, overall, I think it's a fun game. Varied, for sure. Imperfect, but yeah, I think overall more worked than didn't work, at least for me.
I think that, like, I know this is going to sound weird for, like, fans of House of the Dead, but, like, a RPG... survival horror House of the Dead game could work with like light gun gameplay, you know, for the action scenes with some talking branch dialogues and like whatever you choose or whatever is a different outcome in a different stage. I mean, I just thought when I saw D2, I was like, I could see something bigger for like a light gun game. You know what I mean? Because of the way they did it here.
Absolutely.
So I thought it was cool, that aspect of it. And that's something I would obviously want to see them do more of if they ever... well, it's never going to happen now because, you know, Kenji Eno has passed away. Right. But that's what I would have wanted to see. But let's talk about the muse... Oh, I got to go through all these... So, yeah, let's talk about the music. This is the... What I say? The first... Well, let's see. The game was directed, written, produced, and partly programmed by Kenji Eno himself. But guess who composed the soundtrack as well? Him, of course. Because, I mean, if you're going to be directing it, writing it, producing it, and also be a programmer on the project, you might as well do the music at this point.
Of course.
But yes, I'm sorry. I'm trying to put the pictures up here on this side. It's just that I went all the way back. Oh, here we go. So yeah, that's how involved he was with the game. You could tell this is like his pet project. In Kenji Eno fashion, the soundtrack is pretty compelling and unique. First of all, with the naming of the tracks, each track on the soundtrack from disc one, there are 24 tracks on the disc. Each one is called Distraction. Like, that's all. Distraction number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and then it starts again for to 15. And then The second one was called Decode, the songs on the second disc. And there was only two songs. The soundtrack, sadly, has only seen one release back in December 17th, 1999, in Japan only, as part of Sega's Mill CD. Remember those? Do you know what those are? M-I-L CD.
Remind me, because I kind of feel like I've done something with this recently.
So... a Mill CD stands for Music Interactive Live CD, created by Sega in 1998 that added multimedia functions to normal CDs that you would be able to use on the Dreamcast. Sadly, no major labels actually supported it. There was 8 CDs that came out. 2 of them were Sega releases. Some of them were like Japanese bands that were released, or like Warner Brothers released like one, I think. One of the albums was D2 soundtrack, and the other one was called Space Channel 5 Ooh La La the Movie. Those are the only two Sega ones that released in Mill CD. Sega actually stopped. Oh, I actually put it on here. Do you own any Mill CDs? Mill CDs were the reason the Dreamcast got hacked early. In hindsight, it was a bad move, but do you think Sega should have upped the security on the Dreamcast? One of the things that was crazy about the Dreamcast was how unsecure it was. Like, literally, it took like a week for people to hack it. So it's like, all right. But yeah, the way that they first booted fake games were because of the Mill CD technology. They exploited it. That's why future Dreamcast games didn't even support it. And they stopped it. They just forgot about it. Like, obviously, they buried it because even us hardcore fans don't really talk about it, right?
Right, yeah. No, and I know you're asking me if I own any. I don't. I knew of the format, but I guess I just didn't think much about it. Like, that there were actually releases that played on the Dreamcast.
Yeah, I kind of want to pick one up. I'm sure there's videos online on what it came with. You know, collectors online probably did videos on it. I think it's interesting. Right. Have you ever bought a CD that came with some sort of technology that tried to add multimedia to it?
Yes, I have a lot of, not a lot, but a handful of discs for the Sega CD, which can do the, I forget what they call it, but it's like the karaoke discs, you know, where you put it in, it plays music, and there's graphics that play. Of course, the intention is to have the lyrics play, but sometimes people get creative and they'll put images up and things like that. So there was, I forgot what it was called, rock music or something, or rock paintings. I forgot what it was called. But yeah, there's been a few releases.
Okay. The only one that I remember was like way back when I was leaving high school. This band, I don't know if you ever heard of the band, in 2005 released an album, Judas Priest. They were really, really like popular. I was really into them. And they released this album called Angel of Retribution, and like they had this new disc format on it where like one side it was the CD, and then like you would flip it and it would be like a DVD. It was basically a DVD and CD, but just double-sided. But they were trying to push it at like this new format that was revolutionary, and that the DVD had the better sound, and that that's the way you should be listening to it. Literally never heard about it after that album came out. So I don't know. So yeah, there's been a lot of people that have been trying to do multimedia CDs for a while. Sadly, this didn't happen for Sega. This would be the first of the D series of games that was that Eno actually wrote the soundtrack for. Even though he felt like he was a musician and not a developer in his early career, It seemed he was happy to let other musicians he was a fan of compose the soundtracks. According to legend, Eno locked himself in a hotel room with composer Michael, Neiman, until he recorded the Enemy Zero soundtrack in 6 hours. What are your thoughts on the D2 soundtrack? Do you think it has its own style compared to the rest of the games? I do know there's like some acoustic tracks that randomly show up that I really, really like. I really like acoustic tracks. A lot of it was like dance music, right? Sometimes.
Right.
Yeah. So what are your thoughts on the...
It's good. It's unique. I don't know if I'd like put it on to like hang out to, but now that you talk about Mill CD, I was looking at eBay and I can't find any of them. None of them are up there. So
everything opens back up and you go to Japan, some lady will just give it to you randomly.
I'll show up and I'll be like, "Do you have any Mill CD? Arigato. Do you have any Mill CDs?
Arigato, ma'am.
Arigato, ma'am.
I would love it, dude. You can do blog style videos on our channel when you go.
What's up, guys? Look at this guy. This guy didn't sell me Mill CDs. This asshole over there. Yeah.
Would you shame them? I was going to say, but yeah, the soundtrack for me.
Shame.
Unique, cool. I'm glad that Kenji Eno was so involved in the last game that he created, so I'm happy about that. So I'd say outside of Kenji Eno interviews, him doing public appearances in Japan, so I don't think there was that much advertisement for this game. Outside his interviews, outside some stories, there wasn't really commercials, there wasn't really ads. Even though we got ads for Blue Stinger and Code Veronica, it seemed this one went under the radar. So so let's talk about his legacy, unless you want to say, do you agree that this game wasn't really hyped? I mean, you said yeah, right?
No, not at all. Not in America. I mean, you didn't even see like those party inside the Dreamcast commercials with like the D2 with like Laura partying with Sonic. You know, they didn't do that. Fleugen Brothers got in, but not Laura.
They should have definitely done Laura. Like, she's a digital... Her and Ooh La La, like, going back and forth as the two idols would have been so funny, dude, because they're both digital actors. That would have been
awesome.
But, yeah. So let's talk about the legacy. This is probably some stuff that some people won't like to hear on here, but D2 was panned by critics at the time of release, according to Met... I don't want to say pan, I would say lukewarm. Metacritic for the game was a sexy 69%, but the user score is actually 8.0. One of the biggest complaints is that the game moves pretty slow and had repetitive aspects to it. Here's a snippet of a few reviews I took down. GamePro said, "Taken with a healthy dose of tolerance, D2 really shouldn't be a bad game to add to your collection." Planet Dreamcast gave it a 45%, saying, "Although D2 is stylish as other Warp titles have been proven to be, it just isn't any fun, and my rate of complaints make it a rental at best." All Dreamcast... You remember when there were so many Dreamcast sites, everyone had their own, like... They had, like, IGN and then Planet Dreamcast, which was IGN.
I remember,
and,
yeah.
Yeah. This one's called All Dreamcast. Gave it a 60%. And he said, "An almost complete lack of gameplay, very cheesy dialogue, and a whole lot of boring repetition keep Kenji Eno's latest creation from being anything more than a complete dud." I think it said dude on the actual one. Which could be what the D stands for. Just kidding, I think. Passive-aggressive hate. So what do you think about... I mean, I do agree that there's some repetitiveness to the game, but the game is like less than 9 hours. So to me, it's like...
Right.
You guys are acting like you guys were playing a 80-hour RPG that you did the same thing over and over again for 80 hours. So when it's not that long, I would say it's a bit repetitive. They do have some good points here, but as you can tell, user score is 8.0 and definitely 20%, almost 20%. Higher. No, actually, no, it's less. It's like 11%. But still, it's still a lot higher than the reviewers. So I think fans agree with us and not you. So screw you, dude. What do you think about all these sites that reviewed the game back in the day? I don't remember what Dreamcast Magazine reviewed it, but yeah. I don't think they did. I think they might have not had time to do this one.
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know if they got to it in time. I mean, the magazine folded, but I'll have to look into it. But yeah, I mean, it is what it is. I can't... complain too much about other people's opinions. I'm not them, but I do think it's interesting looking back at these so many times when people go, I'd rent it. Rent it. And I'm like, yeah, it's easy to say rent it in 1999. You go to Blockbuster Video or whatever. Nowadays, we can't rent anything. You know, like, I think it's so funny. You see reviewers nowadays and they still kind of throw out the rent, like, buy it, try it, or skip it. And I'm like, well, what's try it? Like, how do you try a game? You know,
we gotta start a rental shop where we just rent retro games and retro movies on VHS. That way, oh, people are like, try it, and they're like, oh, can I please rent Panzer Dragoon Saga? Let me get
way. You know what's gonna happen? They're gonna rent it, and then it won't come back, and then they have to pay the late fee,
which is $10,000.
That happened with Netflix when they were doing the DVDs. They still do, and people will be like, oh, this went out of print. It's worth $100. But the disc is on Netflix, so people would rent it, never return it, and then pay like $20, you know?
Well, we'll charge them actual book, you know, value of the game, plus 20% interest for our time.
That works. I like that.
So Kenji Eno stepped away from gaming after D2. During promotional, he would actually tease that he... Like, it's kind of weird because when he was promoting D2, he didn't just come out and say, this is my last game. You're playing the last game I'm ever going to do. But when the game came out, he started saying he was leaving gaming. But when he was promoting the game, he did talk about the future of Warp. He kind of teased that there was a... He talked about Real Sound 2. He still said it wasn't happening at any time, but... He also talked about an RPG he was making, which didn't really have that much detail, and even talked about the rumored Game Boy video game he was supposedly working on. None of this saw light of day. So here is what he told GameSpot back in the day. We're not sure. We have other projects that we can't tell you about for the Sega Dreamcast. We've been using the hardware for about 3 years now for developing our games, and I think we are one of the companies quite comfortable using the hardware. Even though it seemed at this point he was going to continue making games, he surely semi-retired by stepping away from gaming, saying, there was no single huge reason that I decided to step out of video games, but there were a lot of small ones. D2 didn't sell particularly well, so I decided it was time to step away and take a break. This was in 1999 or maybe 2000. His break and stepping away from the industry kind of lasted a whole decade almost. What is your opinion on someone like Kenji Eno stepping away from gaming? Pretty much, in my opinion, in the prime of his career, because D2, I think it culminated to a lot of like, oh, we're experimenting with D and then Enemy Zero. And I think this was where he put all of it together. Finally, and right. Then he just gave up. He's like, didn't sell enough, I'm out.
Yeah, it's hard to say. I'm trying to think of like artists who had such a like, I mean, he was what? He worked in gaming from the late 80s to the late 90s, right? And then he kind of returned briefly. Right. But you know, I'm trying to think of like other game developers or even film directors who had like a brief career and then died young. I mean, I can only think of actors, you know, like James Dean or Heath Ledger or something like that. But Eno's, he's a different one. He's like a guy who made some really interesting groundbreaking games that people did not see as being groundbreaking at the time. And then he stepped away, you know, like I really can't think, like, he's almost like, and I talked about it on the last episode, it's kind of like if George Lucas made Star Wars and Star Wars failed, and no one wanted to see it, and then he just, like, quit making films, you know, which he would have, you know, well, and so.
It's like,
yeah.
If he made Empire, and then he made Return, and then he's like, I'm out, I'm done right here, and then all of a sudden, like, he dies, and then all of a sudden his movies are basically, like, these cult classics, I would say.
Like, I mean, I guess, like, but Eno, I would say, only had really, like, maybe one big game of his career, which was D, and that mainly sold really well in Japan. So it's almost like he did get another chance and another chance, but the games he released just did not do as well as he wanted to. And you also see this when we discussed D. He was like, if this game does not sell well, I quit the industry.
I can see him making deals. He did it again here. Yeah, I can see him making deals like that.
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
So I guess he, I mean, like we talked about, he directed it, he wrote it, he produced it. He did almost everything on this game. This is his baby, right. And it failed. Definitely could see him being very heartbroken over that and not wanting to work on other projects, especially on Dreamcast. Right. Because he said it was a lot of little things, and I think the promotion for the game was terrible in America. And I think he, I mean, I don't think he ever said it, but let's be honest, would you be happy? I mean, he was a guy that like loved promoting games. You know, he obviously did all these weird things because he knew it would sell games, and Sony of America just super half-assed his game, sadly.
Right.
So what was Kenji Eno doing during the decade? He renamed his studio from Warp to Super Warp, and then changed from working on games to creating DVDs, network services, and online music. According to Wikipedia, he worked on 20 to 30 highly diverse projects, including creating cell phone purchase interfaces for Coca-Cola vending machines, marketing cigarettes, and designing trendy hotels. While Super Warp seemed to be successful, Kenji Eno would disband it in 2005 and said it was him distancing himself from the Warp name and its past. But it gets a bit confusing because while Super Warp was disbanded, according to Wikipedia, he renamed it Yellow to Orange in 2001. But I think that might be an error, maybe 2006, because, like, I don't know. I don't know. The dates are wrong. Some of these Wikipedia entries for Kenji Eno's, like, the dates are all weird. So he did name it. There's a website for it still up. Yellow to Orange. So that is a website. It is a thing. So regardless, at the time, he hinted in 2006 that he might have a project for the Nintendo Wii. Kenji announced the game You, Me, and the Cubes in EGM magazine. Eno would team up with Kenichi Nishi, who worked on Chibi-Robo and Captain Rainbow games for Nintendo. Other games that are, I think, kind of underrated. I mean, most Nintendo games are known by everyone, but nobody really plays Chibi-Robo or Captain Rainbow. So I would say he's kind of underrated in a way for Nintendo published creators. According to Nishi, the reason that Eno contacted him was because he wrote a big detailed post about good curry, which made Eno contact him to talk about the food. He didn't talk about gaming. He actually wanted to talk about curry. Eno talking about his return. This is what he said. I was thinking about coming back into games sooner than I actually did, but it was hard for me to get into the mood. According to the article, it says, what jolted Eno back into gaming was the introduction of the Wii controller. He says, one day I was watching a streaming video on the web just by chance of Nintendo president Iwata demonstrating the Wiimote. After the presentation was over, I couldn't get it out of my head. He says, it got to the point where using a piece of paper, I made a 3D model of the controller for myself. I got in contact with the people at Nintendo and off we went. While the Wii game You, Me, and the Cubes went under the radar, it actually got a higher Metacritic than D2 at a nice 79%. With people saying its unique gameplay, highly addictive multiplayer, and lively characters as positives. While users gave it a 7.0. Some people are saying that it's more about luck, the games, than it is actually puzzle solving. Have you played the game?
I haven't. I'd like to, but it seems like it's WiiWare, so you can't anymore, right? Yeah. Unless you hack your Wii.
Or if you go on Windows on your computer, download the emulator Dolphin, and then pirate it. I mean, it's free. I know people are going to be like, pirating. I'm like, tell Nintendo to get the WiiWare games and put their asses on the Switch, and I'll go buy it on my Switch, and I'll play it on my Switch. Not a big deal. I mean, I'm not afraid of paying for it, but when you literally don't let us do anything, it's a little, like, kind of weird. So here's we got a trailer for it. Did I put the link on here? I'll put it on right now. I don't think I did. Or you could just Google it, but I could put it. I'll put it under the question on the notes.
Gotcha.
Tell me when you're ready.
Ready.
You, me, and the cubes. Somewhere else, there are strange creatures called Phallos.
Oh, of course.
You can create Phallos within your Wii remote by shaking it up and down.
It's like an explanation, right? Of the game?
I guess so.
It's supposed to be the trailer. So.
Oh, they're people.
Yeah. So you have to keep it?
Walk around on their own and help each other stay on the cube.
So you have to balance it and help them not fall off.
You'll need to fling a set number of Phallos onto the cubes before time runs out.
It's kind
of
like Choo Choo Rocket, I guess, in a way. You have to, like, guide them.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
They go anywhere they want, so you have to figure out their patterns. So this is going to be complicated. Look at how many people there is in this one right here. Ridiculous.
How do you do this? You know, it reminds me, too, of Crush.
Mm-hmm. Or, like, the look of his new games or whatever, always, like, we'll look at the new one that they were trying to Kickstarter after he died, but they always, mm-hmm. all these games always look like, what's his name's game that left Sega? Oh, the Luminous? Those puzzle games?
Yeah, yeah, it looks like that, beats? For sure.
It definitely reminds me of this, or his Rez, or his Tetris effect that he made after even that, so it's like, I don't know if they're friends and he's inspired by it, or they all just... Everyone just came in Japan, came up with the same idea for the look of stuff. So
interesting.
During the same time, he worked on You, Me, and the Cubes. He also did outsource work for some mobile games, including composing for Nitonica 1-3 and designing 1-dot enemies on the iPhone. They're all iPhone games. It really seemed that Kenji Eno was out of the industry from 2010 all the way to his death, sadly. Not to say that he didn't have projects in the works or ideas that he was working on, but he didn't release any games during this time period. Let me put the page up. Oh, no. From on February 20th, 2013, Kenji Eno passed from hypertension, leaving behind a legacy of games that, frankly, he tried to run away from in the last 15 years of his career. But seeing mm-hmm. his legacy, the types of games he jumped from making... So my thing with him is like, okay, so he made all these games. He tried to run away from these games, but I feel like the games that he ran away for are basically going to be his success story. Like, I think when people look back at him... they're going to be thinking about Enemy Zero, D2. These are games and franchises he didn't want to be associated with in his later life. Do you think I personally think that... what were your initial thoughts when he passed away? And do you think we wasted a lot of years of ideas that he could have came up with because of his, like, leaving the industry and refusing to come back?
You know, it's hard to say. I feel like if he hadn't passed away, he would... have probably just continued to do what he's doing, not do too many video game things, and kind of fade away into obscurity, and people go, oh yeah, I remember D? I mean, I honestly think his death put a spotlight on his games. I don't think we would be doing this episode, especially with like a two-parter, if he had not passed away, which sounds unfortunate, but like, you know, we're all going to die. You would like to have some good come from your, like, you know, like, leave... Right?
Don't tell
Sorry
everyone.
To tell you that.
Don't tell everyone about that.
But, you know, I'd like to leave some sort of legacy or have people remember me. And, you know, if that's the positive, then that's the positive, that we remember his games and we're actually playing them and paying more attention to them than we would have had he been alive. But... you know, it's just, it's such a real shame. And when I learned about it, I just knew of D and D2, and I was like, wow. You know, it was just, I didn't know he was so young. I didn't know he had such a small gamography, and there's so much I've learned about him since then, especially from doing these, so.
I don't really know.
It's a jumble of thoughts.
I think it's tragic that he didn't get to like live out the VR era that we're living in, because I think a lot of his games would have kind of benefited from having VR. I think he would have been excited. Yeah. As you could tell, he was excited about the Wiimote, and it spurred him out of depression or at least gaming or designing funk to come back to the industry. So I would say VR might have been the next logical step for the man. But he wasn't completely done. So let me go to the notes. He supposedly, well, he passed away to without fulfilling a lot of projects. 3 years later, before his passing, in a previous unpublished interview, Eno told Kotaku about Real Sound 2. He said, "Yes, I'll make one sometime, I promise," Eno said with a laugh. "I apologize if I say that and I end up dying." Little did he realize the impact of his words would have years later. And this is what Kotaku wrote. He ended the interview with Kotaku talking about making games, saying, "Simply put, it's hard. Game development is hard. It's long and it's long. Even when you're done, you still have days of endless testing and adjusting. I never want to do that again." A year after his passing, an unannounced game he was working on made the rounds online. The game was called Kakakun or Kakuzun, that was supposed to combine the idea of mathematics and the universe, where players solve math problems against a 3D environment. The game at the time was in the works for PC and smartphones, and according to Naoya Sato, programmer of the D trilogy, the company, including a lot of past Warp members, employees, launched a crowdfunding campaign to make the game. The game was supposed to launch a year after his death, and they were trying to get $146,000. The campaign would be wiped off the internet. Like, I can't access it. There's two of them that he did. And then they would later come back again on Indiegogo in 2014, this time for an additional $47,000. This time, there was an actual trailer with some gameplay. The trailer's on your thing. We're not going to watch all of it. I'm going to skip through it if you're watching it on the video. But it's basically a lot of shapes and like kind of what me, you, and the cube, or like it, you would expect an indie game to look like. Maybe go 30 seconds in. There's a lot of like weird. It kind of reminds me of Rez or that other game that the Rez creator made, The Child of Eden.
Yeah.
Graphically. So it's a very weird game. It has like tethering and like I don't know. It's weird. It's like, I don't know what he was inspired to make with this game. A mathematical game seems weird. But what's your? I mean, sadly, all the fundraising sites have been deleted by Warp 2, and we don't know if it really got funded or not. But doing some Googling before the game completely fell off the radar, one of the last stories online was that the team was hoping for a Christmas miracle in funding. So I will say it probably didn't happen since, well, obviously we never got a new game. You can go on their website. I think if that video I sent you is their actual YouTube account. And the last time was 5 years ago, the last update. So what are your thoughts on, what is it called, the Kakuzun, and would you have thought Kenji Eno would make a math game? Like, as one of his...
What I find really interesting is that you take his first... those three games, and then you compare them to these later games. Like, as we were talking earlier, I downloaded 1.Enemies.
Oh, yeah, you got it?
Yeah, so I got it here. It's free.
Oh, there you go. So you can
download it. But it
no personality.
You know, this is the screen. This is the game. Look, there's nothing on the screen.
Nice. maybe it's made
by... Oh my God. There are enemies. They are a pixel.
Ooh, graphically like amazing.
Can you see them? You can't even see them. They're little. There's one. You see it?
No, it's too bright. There. The phone. Yeah, no, you can't see. Oh,
I got it.
Yeah, that's...
And,
I don't have an iPhone, so I can't play it.
Oh. They look like there are, like, bed bugs on your phone. This is actually kind of neat. But it does not feel like it's the same guy. And so no. I have to wonder if himself decided to take a break from realism and from demons and deep stories and just become a developer to make really games. Wacky little games. The only comparison I could make is maybe Yuji Naka, when he went from Sonic Adventure and Sonic 06 to tap the teddy bear and make him stand up.
Oh, yeah.
On the SegaBits Discord, I think I was a little mean to him. I think I said maybe he never was a great developer. I feel bad saying that now, but, you know, I do have to wonder, like, some of these guys, like, you know, we praise Yu Suzuki, but then when Shenmue 3 comes out, like, Ryo Hazuki's, like, eating every 5 seconds so he can run. You know, like, these are weird decisions. These are bad decisions.
It's almost really like sometimes having a big company come up to you and saying, you're not doing that. It might be like a good idea.
Yeah, and so I don't know if he's ever really experienced that, but it seems like taking away Warp and really giving him a much smaller budget and everything, he has created some pretty interesting things, but like One Dot Enemies is a huge departure from D2, just as this Kakakun or whatever it's called game Kakazoon? Is Kakazoon. Yeah, that's it what, just...
I looked at
and
the
I
name
can see why
and they were saying it, and that's how they said it in the video, so I was like, Kakazoon.
Right, and I guess I can't... I can see why it didn't get funded, because it does not scream Kenji Him. Eno. No.
No, yeah.
At all. But that might be him. Because we saw Yu, Me, and Dupree, or whatever it is. Yu, Me, and the Cubes.
The Cube, there you go, yeah. what other games from his past do you think or would like to see resurrected or remastered in a way?
I would like to see a fully 3D version of D. I think that would be really cool. I think fans could easily do that because they are really simple environments, and going first person would be easy too. I'd also love to see D2, of course, released to modern, at least to Steam. I think that would be nice. I don't think you're going to see it on like Xbox or anything. And then Real Sound, like we talked about, I'd like to see that translated. So, and then his back catalog, like there's some weird things that have never released over. And at this point, like just do a celebration collection where it's like D2, Enemy Zero, Real Sound with the first ever English translation and some wacky things thrown in. Why not? You know, yeah, celebrate the guy.
I would love to see Real Sound 2 or 3, like the script or any like progress he had done for it released. Like, if we're not going to get the game, I would rather see what his idea was for a trilogy. I would love to see what he wrote for a comedy game. That would be interesting. But that's the end of our episode for D2. Barry was going to read you want to say bye to the guys and then read the Patreon messages?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, thanks for watching, and we'll be back next time. I don't know what we're going to be covering, so that'll be a surprise. But if you support us on Patreon at any level, you get to have your memories read at the end of the show, unless you pick the episode and then we read it at the beginning of the show. You also have the option to submit an MP3 file if it's your game that you picked, and we'll play that with your beautiful voice. But let's see who has commented this time. We have a few here. We have Jake Workak. and he said, Workakla, when I first played D on the 3DO in the mid-90s, I was blown away, oh look at that, wow, by how atmospheric and scary it was. I remember reading in magazines about a sequel coming out for something called the M2, and I was totally on board for this mystery system. Then it was canceled, and I ended up not getting around to playing D2 until around 2015 for whatever reason. And when I did, I was surprised by how much I dug it. The weird over-the-top story and campy voice acting really did it for me. There's something about the late 90s and early 2000s, early 3D graphics and mediocre voice acting that I have such a strong nostalgia for. Yeah, it definitely is a nostalgic thing now to have bad voice acting.
For sure.
Nicholas Schaefer says, I had no knowledge of this series until your last episode, and now I'm stoked for the next pod on D2. We definitely lost a wonderful voice in the gaming space too early, and then we already read Tyler's at the opening of the show. So I think that's a good way to close the show in memory of Kenji Eno. We salute him and thank him for the games that he did give us, and check out some of those oddball ones, you know, like the I was having fun kind of tapping single pixels on my phone. That was kind of fun, actually. I might do that some more.
All right. Thank you guys for watching. See you guys next time. Bye.
Bye.